नमस्कार आदाब, आप सभी का स्वागत है डेली राउंडअप में। मैं हूं सुमेधा।
एंड आई एम प्रशांत, एंड हियर द मेजर स्टोरीज फॉर द डे।
विशेष रूप से जो स्टोरी हम आपको दिखा रहे हैं वो है बिल्किस बानो की। कल भी डेली राउंडअप पे हमने बिल्किस के बारे में चर्चा की थी और गुजरात के उस रायट्स के बारे में भी आपको बताया था। आज हम बताने वाले हैं आपको एक प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस के बारे में जो बिल्किस बानो ने एड्रेस किया था नई दिल्ली में, और इसका एक बहुत ही इम्पॉर्टेंस इस बात पर है कि उन्हें 50 लाख की धनराशि सुप्रीम कोर्ट द्वारा दी जा रही है, उन्हें कॉम्पनसेशन फाइनली मिल चुका है, पर उनकी एक बहुत ही लंबी कठिन एक तरह से लीगल फाइट रही है अपनी जस्टिस के लिए। और हमने विशेष रूप से चर्चा की है उनके लॉयर शोभा गुप्ता के साथ भी, और कल हम चर्चा करने वाले हैं बिल्किस बानो के साथ। पर सबसे पहले देखिए शोभा गुप्ता जो उनकी लॉयर हैं, जो उनके साथ रही थी पूरी टाइम इस लीगल फाइट के लिए, उनके साथ हमने एक चर्चा की है। आइए देखते हैं उस चर्चा की ओर।
टू मेंटेन द लॉ एंड ऑर्डर, टू मेंटेन द रूल, यू हैव क्रिएटेड अ बॉडी दैट इज पुलिस डिपार्टमेंट। दे आर सपोज टू मेंटेन दैट, दे आर सपोज टू मेक शो दैट यू आर फीलिंग सेफ। यू आर मीन्स एनी सिटीजन ऑफ द कंट्री इज फीलिंग सेफ। नाउ दैट लिम कांट फेल। If that limb fail, where would you go? A person, citizen is suffering from another citizen, where would we go? We go to the police, we go to the state, we go to the courts. Here, that first wing failed badly. So, looking to this case where the guilty officials have been punished, not only they have been convicted under the penal laws, disciplinary action has been taken, their benefits have been taken away by way of the disciplinary action, it should be set an example, and this judgment should be publicized. Should be a role of media that the state governments are taking that seriously, that they are informing their police officials, and police officials also, they are otherwise supposed to. There would be hardly few who would not be doing their job properly. But for those who don't do, and if they fail, the state government must take proper action. Here in this case, everything failed.
हमारी दूसरी खबर के लिए हम आपको लेके चलते हैं एकेजी भवन नई दिल्ली में, जहां पर हमने विशेष रूप से चर्चा की है वीजू कृष्णन के साथ, जो कि ऑल इंडिया किसान सभा के जॉइंट सेक्रेटरी हैं। हमने खास तौर पे कृषि संकट, जो कि इलेक्शन में एक बहुत ही बड़ा मुद्दा बनकर के आया है, उस पर बात की, और उन्होंने हमें बताया कि किस तरह से कांग्रेस और बीजेपी दोनों ने ही किसानों के मुद्दों को एक तरह से फेल किया है, और लेफ्ट ही किसानों की बातों को समझ रहे हैं, और उसके लिए एक स्ट्रैटेजी लेफ्ट ने किस तरह तैयार की है।
While BJP is talking about doubling farmers' incomes, it is sticking to the Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana and so on, and it towards the end it came with the Kisan Samman Nidhi.
Right.
So which is talking about 6,000 rupees for a farmer owning up to 2 hectares.
And that in an entire year.
In a year. So that would be about 500 rupees a month, 17 rupees a day. But let us see, both these manifestos are silent on this C2 plus 50.
Right.
It is only the CPIM which is very clear that it will enforce this C2 plus 50 as the MSP. And in both these cases, if you look at the C2 plus 50, if that was given in the case of paddy, right, in most parts of India, farmers are getting between 800 to 1000 only, though the MSP of paddy is 1750 per quintal because there is no procurement. In Kerala, it is 2350. Now it has been increased to 2650. So even if you take a hectare of land, Bengal or Bihar, the production is around 4 tons per hectare. So the farmer is getting about 40,000. If it was 1750, it should have been around 70,000. If it was even 2350, let us not take the 2650, 2350, then the farmer in Bengal or Bihar would have got about 65,000 rupees more per crop. And it is in such circumstances he is talking about 6,000 rupees. And the Congress manifesto says it will allow more private players to enter into all these areas. Whereas we have been very clear that public investment is required. cooperatives should play a role, and also the panchayats in procurement, because the network of procurement, it has to be much more wider.
Just like the Kerala government has been trying to implement in last few years, right?
Yeah. It is the Kerala government has that has helped in production of paddy and all that, some of these policies.
And cooperatives play an important role.
Truly, because you see, in most of the cases, there is no, other than procurement, even where there is procurement, there is nothing done by the government in terms of value addition and marketing. It is totally again in the hands of the private sector. So here cooperatives could play a role where the profits that accrue from it can be plowed back to the farmers.
The US recently announced that all waivers on sanctions on importing oil from Iran would end on May 1st. That basically means that any country which imports oil from Iran after May 1st will face US sanctions. India is one of the major importers of oil from Iran and is likely to face a lot of economic difficulties. To find out more about what impact this would have on India and the logic of the US decision, NewsClick talked to Ambassador Talmiz Ahmad. Here is what he had to say.
I think this is going to be a disaster for India. We are not only major importers of Iranian oil, but Iranian oil is sold to us at concessional rates because of the line of credit given to us for 60 days. We also they take care of the insurance and freight as well. So the landed cost of Iranian oil is far cheaper than any comparable oil that you might get. For example, you have seen in the media, certain other countries like Saudi Arabia and the UAE have hastened to say that we will make up for Iranian oil. But you cannot make up for these concessions. Saudi Arabia does not sell oil at concessional rates ever. Now, when you buy oil with a line of credit of 60 days, do recall that within this period, that crude oil gets monetized. And you have already sold in the open market, very often in the international market, you have actually sold the product. So you are paying back after you've already monetized the import. It's a very major aspect. So I would say to you that there are two aspects to this. One is economic, commercial and economic, and the other is political. This is a serious problem for India. Because in Washington today, you have what is effectively a rogue regime. It is a regime that neither understands nor implements international norms and rules. Is the world to accept this scenario in toto? You have a president who, because of deep-seated personal prejudices, initiates certain policies. The policies are articulated aggressively. They are pushed forward in a very hostile manner against a nation that obviously has done no wrong. I mean, we have a nuclear agreement. The Iranians have fulfilled all their obligations. This is a solemn agreement that not only was approved by the United States, it was approved by all the United Nations Security Council members and is part of the UNSC resolution. So beyond the UN resolution, beyond the nuclear agreement, the president has now gone on to tightening the sanctions. I see this effectively as blackmailing the international community for reasons that are completely unfathomable as far as I am concerned. I mean, you are telling countries which have good relations with Iran, which have very substantial ties with Iran connected with their national interest, to effectively cut off these ties. I cannot see any rationale for this. So I think that what you will really see is a scenario where over a period of time, the United States continues to discredit itself, lose all credibility, and the international community will say, go to hell.
We live in times when leaders of some of the biggest democracies in the world, including our own, are casually throwing around comments regarding the use of nuclear weapons. Lest we forget, here is a look at what would actually happen if we ended up using some of these weapons.
Have we forgotten the horrors of nuclear war? On April 22, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi said in a campaign speech in Rajasthan that India's nuclear arsenal was not being saved up for Diwali, implying his readiness to use them. US President Donald Trump has also casually talked about nuclear weapons on several occasions, In an interview with MSNBC, while on the campaign trail in 2016, he wondered why nuclear weapons are being made if they're not going to be used.
American president.
Why are we making them? Why do we make them?
As two important world leaders seem so cavalier about using nuclear weapons, it is important to remember the kind of damage these weapons can cause. In 1945, towards the end of World War II, two relatively small nuclear bombs were dropped by the US on Japan, causing widespread devastation. In Hiroshima, a 15-kiloton bomb killed around 140,000 people on August 6. And in Nagasaki, a 20-kiloton bomb dropped on August 9 killed around 80,000 people. The impact of the radiation continued to take lives for the next few months and left future generations afflicted with genetic disorders. The bombs also almost completely wiped out both the cities. In case a nuclear exchange did take place between India and Pakistan today, the casualties would be much greater than what we have seen in the past. If the largest known nuclear weapon tested by Pakistan, a 45-kiloton bomb, was dropped on Mumbai, over 4 lakh people would be killed and over 6.5 lakh people would be injured. And if India's largest known bomb of 60 kilotons was dropped on Karachi, the death toll would be similar, with 10 lakh likely to be injured. But the impact is not limited to the loss of lives. A nuclear war between two countries could spark a nuclear winter, which would end the human civilization as we know it. Carl Sagan warned us about the effects of nuclear winter in a 1983 article. He pointed out that even small nuclear wars can have devastating climatic effects. A nuclear war will result in thousands of fires. The smoke from these fires alone would be enough to generate a long, cold and dark nuclear winter. The fallout from the radiation would result in huge holes in the ozone layer, and the dust and soot from the fires would cover the sky and block out the sun. Temperatures would fall by several degrees. These conditions would persist across the planet for several months or even years. This nuclear winter will be enough to kill all farm animals and stop fruit production. What will be left of the human race after this is difficult to say. And the nuclear arsenal in the world today is capable of achieving this several times over. But all these existential dangers seem to be lost on the two leaders, who regard nuclear bombs as mere campaign props to bolster their strongman image.
That's all we have time for today. To find out more about these stories, check out our website newsclick.in and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thanks for watching.
देखने के लिए शुक्रिया.